Hey everybody, welcome to session two of Robot Hacks, the Make Magazine sponsored event where we are celebrating all things robotics, especially in the open sense. A couple days ago we had our first session, the Master Sessions, where we discussed 21st century robots, looked at Jimmy the Robot, the Olin College team, talked about the work that they've been doing. Brian David Johnson, the Intel futurist, ran us through the ins and outs of the design and creation of Jimmy the Robot, a new forward-thinking approach to building robotics. Today we've got an all-star robotics expert roundup. It's a full show here where we're going to be talking about all sorts of robotics, specifically looking at elements of the hobbyist market, but also some of the things that are happening in the applied robotics world, the academic robotics approaches, and beyond. So one of the things I want to do before we get into this is give everyone that's watching a quick run-through of what Robot Hacks is. This is a four-session program where we discuss robotics with master makers, robotics experts, through these live hangouts as we're doing right now. We are also sponsoring and encouraging robotic-interested teams to build programs and projects that are robotic-related. And we have sent out packages of robotics components and materials to these teams who are updating us on the progress of their builds through our Robot Hacks community page. And I encourage everyone to visit this page. You can get there most easily by going to makezine.com/robot-hacks. You can get the full rundown of the program there. You can click the red button that takes you to the Robot Hacks community page where you can sign up and follow all the progress. And for those teams that are participating, continue to put your progress photos and updates on there. We've seen some great stuff that's coming in, some fun unboxing photos, certain projects that have been started to be put together, and it's very exciting. So with that, let's jump into today's session. We've got Michael Overstreet, who runs the iBioloid project, and he has put together a very impressive team of participants for today. So Michael, thank you, and let's get started. Tell us about what you're working on.
Yeah, hello. I'm Mike Overstreet, and I'm a robotics 3D printer user owner. And I'm just going to kind of jump into a little show and tell real quick. You've probably seen this robot in Make Magazine issue 3.4. It's my Darwin OP clone that I 3D printed out. This is my really cool project. I won't talk about it a lot because I've got so much stuff online about that. And then I'll show my other one. This is my second project. Hope you can see it. This is my 3D printed out version of the Biloid humanoid robot that I take to competitions such as Robo Games and other events like Maker Faires and do Kung Fu and soccer demos with it. And I'm pretty much going all 3D printed now for many different reasons. One, because it's cool and it's fun to do. But I want to say here before we get into this, I think this is a super cool hangout because not only are we talking about robots, we're talking about 3D printing of robots. And I can remember 4 years ago now, or a little over almost 4 years ago now, my hackerspace got a cupcake, and I saw that, and I like was just blown away. And I was like, wow. And I tried to make robot brackets on this thing, and it was frustrating. I spent weeks and weeks and hours trying to print out a usable bracket, but I was hooked. So as 3D printing technology has gotten better and better, now I have an UP printer or Infinium printer, so I actually can print out usable brackets now. So I think this is super cool that that everybody's starting to get into 3D printing of robots. So I can bring up a little issue real quick on my Darwin. One of the things I noticed, because I pretty much have everything up to date on my website and other places about what I've done on it. But what I have noticed is that I used to be a big proponent of ABS, but I have noticed on really thin parts, ABS is really flexible. So at times when the robot is doing any complicated movements or actions, the flexibility starts giving it a little wobble. So I actually am thinking that maybe PLA for thinner robot brackets is the way to go. This kind of changed for me because I've always was a big ABS supporter. And plus that I'm also looking into metals. There's powdered titanium and other metal 3D printers that are super cool. And I think that's maybe my next evolution of this guy. It kind of defeats the purpose of my project because I was trying to make it cheaper. I started printing out in metal, but part of my project is to try to advance the hobby, figure out what you can and cannot do. So that's the kind of a little thing that update on what I'm doing with my Darwin. Then on this guy, he was inspired by Jimmy because I have printed out in brackets for this guy in the past, the last 3 or 4 years, but I really hadn't print the whole robot out. So when I saw Jimmy at the New York Maker Faire, I was like, you know, I should just sit down and start 3D printing out all the brackets for this guy. And that's how kind of this project started. I'm thinking right now my cost is about 1,000. I'm hoping through the CM900 and other stuff that's coming out through Robotis, I can try to get that price under 1,000. So I'll keep posting updates on this project to my website and as far as my progress and what materials and stuff I'm using on them. And other than that, I think we should get on to some of the other really cool people in this hangout so they kind of demo and show off the robot. I see Curry has got his picture up, so I think you're on next, Curry, if you could talk about your really super cool Danger Ball robot.
Oh, make sure to unmute yourself, Michael. I think your mic is off. And for the other participants, if you guys wouldn't mind putting yourselves on mute for the time being, because it sounds like there might be a 3D printer running in the background of one of the windows that'll help keep the sound clean. Thanks.
All right. Hello, everybody. Can you hear me now?
Great. Go ahead.
Hi. My name is Michael Curry. I'm a 3D printing evangelist at MakerBot Industries. What I have with me here is a 3D printed creation that I made actually for the World Maker Faire here in New York a couple of months ago. It's Danger Ball, I call it. It's inspired by basketball because being into robots, I'm not really like the kind of kid who enjoyed chasing the basketball around. I would sit there in middle school and imagine what the other things it could turn into. So this is built actually on the logic of the lines you find on the surface of a basketball. And when it gets an open command, it does that. So this is my personal take on what I believe a robot should be. I am very much into the slightly more fantastic and very much less practical realm of the world. It's just kind of my outlook. I've got a few other robotics projects that I've done over the years, and what's interesting is this one with Danger Ball and this logic of the transforming sphere is actually the first project I ever tried to do with 3D printing 4 years ago. As a matter of fact, when I showed up at the Hackerspace in Kansas City and first met Mr. Overstreet, I walked in with a smaller version of this that was much more crude and said, hey, do you guys have some software I could put in here? Yeah, I've learned a lot since then.
So can you show us that transforming action again?
Absolutely, yeah. He'll actually fold back up. Right now, I still kind of have to hold him because there's some areas where there's a little too much force.
Cool. That is fantastic.
My personal favorite feature here is actually the glowing red eyeball switch.
Yeah.
I needed a switch, and a friend just happened to have one of these lying on his desk here, so it was the perfect marriage.
That's great. That's really great. And then on the inside, can you bring that right up close to the camera? Let's get a good look at what the guts of this thing looks like.
So the guts are way less complicated than they appear. It's actually 16 of the cheapest Metal Gear hobby servos that I could get online. coupled with an Arduino Uno, and then just a 16 servo servo shield that I got from Seed Studio. And the whole thing is being powered by a really inexpensive 5-volt regulator that takes some power out of a battery. So the whole total cost of this thing, not including 3D printers, 3D printed parts, is probably under $200. That said, it won't do any of the things that some of the other fancy robots we're going to see can do yet. This one, I'm still working on a walk sequence and a gait. I actually have a lot of learning that I have to do from the programming side of the project.
And all of the shell, that's 3D printed.
Yeah, the entire structure is 100% 3D printed, except for a couple of M3 bolts that hold them together.
Fantastic. The right in front of the screen, we can see the front part of the body itself, and then there's a green glowing display right behind it. What is that?
The display is actually, that's the That's the voltage regulator, and a nice little feature of the one that I happened to find was it tells you the voltage inside your lithium ion or lithium polymer battery, because once they go flat, that's really bad for them. So it also adds a really nice glowing effect inside, so I can see whether or not the power supply is connected, and it glows slightly evilly when it's sitting there closed.
Yeah.
Ooh.
That's a really important feature in any robot, I find, is how it looks when it's just looking at you.
Yeah, that's great. So this was inspired by your early basketball activities. It's the same size as a basketball?
It's slightly larger than a basketball. I ended up wanting to leave myself a little bit of wiggle room inside. There's a couple of experiments I've done with much smaller versions of this that are more around the size of a grapefruit. The problem ends up being I can get smaller servos, but at a certain point I can't find a way to plug all the cables in the space I have. So I've got to do a little experimentation to see if I can just play with the size more.
And that was one of the interesting things with the last session, as we talked about the 21st century robot and Jimmy the robot, and how I think it was Guy that was talking about how really one of the limitations is with a lot of robotics projects is how do you get all the wiring from one place to another, especially when you have narrow passageways and small joints that need to articulate. So it's interesting to hear. You've encountered that same thing even on your
one issue that I've come up with is I really wanted to keep the cost low because I'd like any project I do to be reproducible by anybody with a 3D printer. The issue starts to become exactly what you're saying with wiring. The inexpensive servos, every single one of them has to be hooked back to the controller.
Right.
So there's a wire from each point back to the brain, as opposed to some of the cooler solutions out there where you can chain all your servos together. I think everybody else in this group can talk to some of the really cool stuff that's out there.
Yeah, that's very cool. So I assume that you can't dribble this like a basketball.
Not yet. the plastic's not quite that bouncy. He'll go down once, but he won't come back up.
Well, that's great. Yeah, I are the design files for this? This is a question I have for everyone. But is this something that you've shared? Is this something that people can get on Thingiverse?
My intent is to share this project. It needs to get a little bit further along in terms of me making it useful to other people. Right now, there's still some of me like making parts fit after they print. So as I get the engineering of those kinks worked out, I'm going to start putting the whole project online.
Got it. And I've got a question from Rick Hill that just popped up online, one of the viewers. He's asking, what percentage of your projects and your robots are ones you've printed yourself?
In my case, I've printed 100% of this on my own. I mean, it's been me and four replicators that I have permanent access to, and I think two spools of filament at this point.
Got it. And Michael Overstreet, what about you?
Most of my robots are 3D printed out on my UP or NVIDIA printer. I do have some of my covers for my Darwin or Shapeways because they're just so difficult to print out. They take like almost 12, 13 hours on my printer, so a lot of chance for failure. So,
right. Great. Well, Michael, this is a very cool project. I like it. I'm excited to see as it comes together.
Me too.
Progress. Make sure to keep sharing with us and keep us updated.
I will.
Super. Well, Michael, do you want to let's jump in the next person? Who do you have lined up next for us?
Okay, Robot Girl, can you kind of like show off some of your latest creations and your 3D printed robot and do a quick demo for us?
Absolutely. So, hello everyone. I'm known as Robot Girl, and these are the robots that I've created. So, the one that looks like a bird is called RoboBird. This one over here is called Buddy Force Addison. And in the back is a tentacle mechanism called Bot Bait.
Bot Bait, you said?
Yep, Bot Bait. So, starting off with RoboBird, this is basically what the robot looks like. And it's all laser cut. The electronics are inside there. It has 4 degrees of freedom but only uses 3 servos. And that's because the beak works off of a Scotch yoke mechanism. And with this RoboBird right here, I can actually control it via an iPad application.
You designed your own control board for that, for your robot bird, didn't you?
Yep. So the brain inside of RoboBird is just an Arduino derivative. And that's what the PCB looks like. It has all sorts of doodles on it and everything.
Cool.
That's amazing. That's really great. So is that derivative board one that you've designed yourself?
It was, I sort of used the Diavolino as a starting point on the design because I was using the same software. And the Diavolino was based off of the Arduino 2009, I believe. So, that was basically the derivative chain of the RoboBird brain board.
Okay. And then you went out and had, this is now, but it's now custom made or custom done by you for your projects.
Yeah. Especially with the screw terminals, it really helps for the wiring of the robot.
Right. And the and the illustrations on the back side, there's no mistaking what the project's designed for.
Exactly.
That's great. So when did you start working on these projects?
RoboBird I started working on a few years ago. It evolved from a popsicle stick robot to eventually this laser cut version, which is now a kit as well. And then it further evolved into a 3D printed version. So I have like a 3D printed bat RoboBird for Halloween. Yeah.
It's awesome.
And one over there.
Yeah, these are very cool. And this is, are these things that are you selling these on your website? Are you sharing the projects with the community? How are you working on this stuff?
Yeah, so I have the kit on my store, on RoboBird.com store, and it's also open source hardware. So you can download the files and laser cut your own version, or 3D print your own versions, or follow the instructables to make it out of popsicle sticks. So
excellent.
Designed to be really accessible to everyone.
That's great. So then, and then you've got Buddy over there on the side. What's the story with Buddy?
So Buddy 4000 was my first real 3D printed robot project once I got my 3D printer. So it's entirely 3D printed and it's very tiny, so all of the electronics are smushed inside there. And that's basically the story of Buddy 4000. This one has been dropped on the floor numerous times and it's still alive, so that's good to know.
Does it use the same electronic setup as the RoboBird?
Sort of similar, but inside of Buddy 4000 is just an Arduino Pro Mini, and it's also wireless, so it has a lithium polymer battery right in the front of it, and yeah, everything is a lot more minimized than RoboBird. But that comes at the cost of, like, every time that I want to add something to it, then I have to dismantle the entire robot, and eventually something breaks, and so it takes a lot of time to make sure that it's all set and everything.
And that's, but it's also 3D printed.
Yeah, it's entirely 3D printed.
Fantastic. Very cool. Okay, the one that I'm really curious about, the RoboBait in the background. I can just see the tentacle of it wiggling around. What is this thing?
Yeah.
So BotBait is a two-stage tentacle mechanism robot. And basically, its tail can move in all sorts of directions really nicely. And the way that I built it was actually using these flexible links made out of Sugrun. Oh. So this is what links the vertebrae in the tail together. And if it's flexible, then the tail can move in whatever way the servos are pulling the fishing line.
Nice.
Very, very cool. So is it, I imagine there's probably, you've got three servos to move it in all directions?
This one's using four servos. So
four servos.
Two of the servos are controlling the upper half, and then the other two, the bottom half.
Great. Is there any way that we can get that one brought a little closer to the camera so we can get a good look at it? I'm really fascinated by this one. And how much control do you have over it?
Well, I've been able to get it to do motions where the tail can move in a circle or back and forth quite reliably. But, of course, there's no real feedback mechanism for this. Like, I can't tell which fishing line is more taut than the other. So it's really mainly just driving the servos in special sequences to make it do different actions.
Very cool. Yeah, I love this one. That's great. That's very, very cool.
So the flexible links that I was mentioning, they're actually made from a 3D printed mold.
I love that. See, and that's one of the things I get excited about 3D printing, the applications where you can actually start doing things like simple mold making or something like this, but it's fantastic to see applications where people are actually doing that. That's really cool to me. Now, is that something, like you said, with the BirdBot, that you have that in the open source available, design file available stuff, is these other ones as well?
Yep, so Buddy for Fasten, it's all open source, and you can even view the 3D files in your browser, so that's pretty cool. And BotBait is also open source, and I think there's a few files for the molds in with BotBait as well.
And you can find all those at robobird.com?
Yep.
Okay, just like it's listed at the bottom of the screen there for you. BRRD.com. Very cool. Thank you for showing us these. I'm excited about that. That bot bait's really fun, and I'm blown away that you designed the iPod app to run these things too. That's impressive. Very cool.
Controls the rover that's in the background there. Yeah.
Very cool.
Super. Well, Michael, what's up next?
Okay. Did Matthew and Chi, are they there? Okay. Well, they were. Here he comes. Now, can you kind of give a kind of brief overview of the CM900? Just came out. It's open source control board, and then kind of the cool things you're doing with it, because that'll lead it right into Aaron showing off the new super cool Darwin Mini.
Okay, let's see. Did you see Everybody see he hear me okay, right?
Hear you great. Yep.
Okay. So the so you can see roughly the size of it is about an inch by 2 inch and a half or something. That's the new CM904.
Can you bring it up just a little bit and bring it right up to the camera so we can get a good look at that?
There we go.
Got it. Great.
All right. So, and what we did is this one is an Arduino-based kind of development system. And we've been working with Malloy systems since about 2008. And one of the things we love the most about it is let me try to share the file. Hang on. I'm new at this one, so hang in there. There you go.
You made it so it's you can do poses with it, which is really cool. Makes it really easy to program your robot.
Yeah. You see this humongous screen here now?
No.
No?
I don't see it yet.
You didn't share the screen at all, Ben. Let's see. Okay. You have to believe me then.
That's cool.
So this one is you can develop code to move the robot around, especially like wheel and interface with sensor. It's the standard everything else. But for us, we are particularly interested in bipedal and humanoid robot for our lab. So we were looking for a way to interface with the new board, but also create motion. So, and recently Matthew, you see him in the back there. Interface with a new design interface with CM9. So it allows us either, if you have a bot with CM9 already, you can use by the way, it's based on the another existing software system called PyPos and Malloy Control, which exists several years back. Basically, he interfaced them. So if you have, let's say, a CM9 based bot already, you can use that PyPos with some addition of his own. You can make poses and it will walk around for you. Or if you happen to have an old bot with a model system which have their own firmware which is closed, and you can create the motion page there and then translate it over. Maybe it's easier to let's see.
Yeah.
We could have screen, so is the older closed firmware system.
What's cool is that you can take codes you made for the old closed system and you can run it on the CM9, right? Now with your software, is that correct?
Right. So it will convert to the compatible Super NAS. So now basically the CM9 now can do regular wheel robot, also multi-link robot and create motion. So that's the new one.
And Curry, this is something you might want to like look into. It's only like $10 for the CM9. Make your life so much easier.
That's great.
Sorry, I didn't mean it. Side there. Can Matthew kind of show off what he's doing with the software, or is that the screen capture for that?
Yeah, the software is ready on this computer, but I've been clicking screen share, but now I can't be
able to see.
Oh, actually, there's a bit different screen here now. Full screen, is that what it meant?
Yeah, you should be able to then jump over to the other tab.
There you go.
Something different now?
Yeah, now we can see your...
Yeah, we can see your...
Your desktop.
Whoa, you got an interesting feature there.
But the cool thing he's doing is he's making this so that the new $10 open source board can basically run all existing robotic software for the robots and stuff. It's really cool.
That's great.
He's doing.
Oh. And she while you're getting there we
there
go.
It is.
Oh, we had it for just a moment there.
But I think you've uploaded this to the Google group, so.
Yeah, I update the explanation, the page up at the Robot Hack page, so people can get into the detail what we did probably better.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll create some kind of interesting Star Trek effect.
Yeah. If you just click the Chi, if you click the Hangout, the screen share button on the side there. It'll kill this feedback loop
okay.
that we caught ourselves into. That's better.
Okay.
So one of the viewers has a question for you, Chi, about
yes.
Which type of servos are better for your applications, faster, most torque. What are you using?
We use a standard AX12 18A a lot. We have some Darwin, so we have used MX28. We have not been using anything else in the robotics family.
Okay.
The Diamnexel servos are really high torque, especially and holding torque, especially designed for robot applications. So they have higher than normal holding torque compared to like a standard servo. That's what he's using.
Great, got it. So what's next with this project? Where are you guys taking it from here?
One part that we were interested in is we're interested in theater robotics. So I work together with the theater department at the University of Georgia. So we want to have, eventually, a robot doing improvisation theater with a real person. One of these days. That's the big plan. Last December, they did already one where actually there's a person kind of in the loop. So they use a Mac software, a commercial software where they interact with the robot. So there's a person in the loop in the room, and there's a person playing a sketch, and then the robot will interact in real time with that person. So we got that done. One cool thing he did is he created a way of motion capture very smooth with the robot. So we would like to be able to reproduce that, attach to the CM9 system, and share that. So essentially. So that's the next
cool.
project for
us. Yeah. So this theater project, it sounds like a pretty ambitious project in itself. That would be great to see. The one that you guys did last year, is there any footage of that available that,
yes,
that people can find?
Yes, it posted right on the YouTube for the robot hack. I probably could put another one. Where it's about 10, 15 minutes long. So it's out on YouTube. I can share it at the robot hack later, probably the best.
Great. Thanks. I would love to see that. That sounds very cool. So
yeah.
This sounds like some interesting research, and I would love to figure out if the screen share aspect can be shared with the community after the hangout's done. Maybe you can get that, if there's some parts of it you can post online that we can take a look at. We can hear more about the stuff that Matthew's doing, and you get to see some more of these pieces of it.
Yeah, we probably could try to do that. We have Camtasia, so we probably can capture how Matthew interfaces with the robot, how he acts as a software, how to run it, and all of that, and then we can load it up.
Great.
Very cool.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much. And if you know, stick around. There's plenty of questions that are popping up under the sidebar here. So we'll be throwing these out and having everyone help answer them as we go along. Thanks, Chi.
Sure.
And then, Michael, you were saying we're going to jump from here over to what Aaron's doing. We've got Aaron
right.
Park from Robotis.
Yeah, they've. This is probably going to be the star of the show because they just come out with, or actually in beta testing, a really super cool new robot called the Darwin Mini. It's basically this guy's little brother, and if they're hoping to get the price point to about, I think, $600 or less.
Yeah, 500 to 600.
500 to 600. I'm just going to let Aaron take it over and kind of demo this robot.
Sure.
It's open source too, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe I can give you a little more detailed information. I'm sure many of you already heard about this open source CM904, but maybe all the specification wise, I can post it on the robot hack later on. But just to give you a little information on, as you see on the screen, it's an open CM904 controller. It's a completely open source. All the hardware and software is completely disclosed and available for users to modify and expand. And the controller board and schematic and layout will be available in Eagle format on GitHub as well. And this software is also available on GitHub, and including the bootloader, core library, processing core, and processing hand as well. But one, I would say a high-performance, low-cost controller board is impressive enough by itself, but what really makes the Robotics Open SIM initiative exciting is the introduction of the new Dynamics XL320 servo. I don't know if you can see on the screen, this is the sample of the mini DAWIN, still a prototype, and hopefully we are planning to release it this coming 2014, and we're talking about maybe possibly at the San Francisco Bay Area Makers Faire in May, be able to release it at the same time. And of course, the new servo featuring the quality and the high performance that Robotics has become known for, and is expected to sell for less than about $25 or $20, and will enable users to easily create cost-effective robot designs anywhere from simple actuators up to completely functional humanoid robot at an affordable price. So maybe I can give you a little demonstration about how it's being used. And one good thing is it is now operated by the OS Android. So maybe I'll show you on the screen. Basically,
there you go.
Very cool.
So on the screen on my smartphone right here, I'm going to turn it on first. Right here in the behind, we have an OpenSIM 904 installed. I don't know if you can see it. And we have two new rechargeable batteries coming out as well, from the behind and the top. And so there's a switch, I can just turn it on. And you see LEDs coming out. We are working more on the LED and the sensors. Hopefully when they show up next year, we'll be much better in shape. So if you can see my smartphone screen, there's an application we can, not available to the public yet, but basically I can just open it up. And the current interface is in Korean, so we are still working on the English version at this time. So all I have to do is just pairing the Bluetooth using it on the smartphone right here, and it says connected right here.
Okay.
And one good thing is we made kind of a GUI interface icon. So if I press sit, it sits down. I was using some other key right here. And standing, I can say movement of the head. And how about a greeting to all the Makersphere community? And right here, also. And right-hand side. And how about, also have some martial act movement that we just programmed. As you can see, a jab on the right-hand side, jab on the left-hand side, a hook, and upper hip.
Very cool.
And here's the thing, I can do a little kicking motion right here. Kick a ball.
Nice. Nice kick.
On the other side. And it has some special move too. Maybe I can show you this one right here. Oops. Maybe.
Oh.
You can get up too, I think.
Draw my little quick better, maybe. Right here.
Do that one more time. It looked like on my side there was a little glitch. I want to see that. I want to see this one. Nice.
Very cool. Very cool.
And I like this move actually, moving sideways. You see it? And it can go forward and backward like this. And it's all right now I'm controlling through the Android. And the other thing is we also enable this to move as a sensor. So I don't know if you see on the screen, which in Korean at this time, but as I do, maybe can you capture my motion maybe? If I do, okay, robot and the, so if I do X like this, I'm sorry.
Maybe.
I turn off the application.
But they also, this is going to be 3D printable too, which is another cool thing.
That's right.
You can put the files online.
So with the motion of sensor, it can also move as well. You see how I do my...
Yeah.
Okay, and...
That's great.
Yeah, I guess this is about it for the mini domain for now, and definitely I can post some more pictures. Actually, I have a screen that I'd like to share with you, mini domain playing a soccer as well here. If you can bear with me for a second.
It's crying out for LEDs in the eyes. That's an upgrade.
Right. LED and other sensors as well. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, we can see the yellow screen. Looks like you're...
Oh, there it goes.
There we go.
Very cool.
Thank you.
Very cool.
You might be able to adjust for me later on.
Awesome. Okay. Very cool.
That's fantastic.
So as Michael mentioned, our main goal as a company is really trying to make a robotic something that anyone can make. And oftentimes, budget has been the main concern. So we are trying to provide affordable kits. OpenCM 904, as I mentioned, will be between $10 version and $20 version. And the XL320, the new servo, will be under $20-$25, guaranteeing the high torque and high quality. And one thing, as you know, always in the mechanical aspect, you might have all the servos, but might have a hard time getting the wire into the controller. So as we see, our servo has a daisy chain which enables to connect other servos and connecting to the controller at once on wire. So that will solve a lot of hassles when you're building a humanoid robot later on. And this is Mini Darwin. It will be an open source, as Michael mentioned. Anyone like to make their own 3D printed Mini Darwin version, definitely they can just download it and make their own robot. And we definitely like to see many, many modifications through the community, from the makers community as well. And the other thing is, so these days, I guess 3D printing really enables everyone to make any of their application. And of course, if you'd like to have some mobility, how about consider robotics, OpenCM 904 and XL3D for your consideration. That would be great.
Yeah, this is a great platform. I think there's a lot of places people can start exploring and do some really advanced work with robotics, with the stuff that you guys are putting together here. Very impressive. We've got a couple questions that have come in for you. Wondering about how many of the new servos are on the Darwin, this mini Darwin that you're showing.
Currently, we are using 18 degree of freedom, so 18 XL320 servos.
Okay. And are you planning on incorporating a gyro or accelerometer into the final product?
It is a possibility. We actually have been trying out having the gyro sensor inputting to the control and doing some demos as well. So possibly it will be coming out as well. Yes.
Okay. Very cool. And one that's actually for Chi, but it does connect to what you're working on. Wondering if Chi's planning on developing CM9 to work with the Darwin OP software.
That's right.
Yep. And it sounds like that is indeed the case. Great questions, everybody. Thanks for submitting these as we're going through everything.
You can run the Darwin OP app on the Raspberry Pi. And hooking up the Raspberry Pi to the CM904 is not that difficult. They actually have a website where you can share the software and so on as Robot Source. And that's just the community to go and share their programming and how they're doing, what they're doing with the CM904.
Great. Let's make sure we'll put that link in the community page for everybody that might be interested in doing that as well, because that's very useful. Well, Aaron, this is exciting stuff. I'm thrilled to hear that you might be unveiling this officially at Maker Faire. So I'll keep my fingers crossed. I get to see and play with this in person in a few months.
Sure, I'll be looking forward to it too.
Yeah, great. So Michael. I think we've got two more people lined up.
Right.
Here. Who are you bringing in next here?
I always say his name, Herberto. Why don't you say your name and introduce yourself to everybody correctly.
Yes, my name is Heriberto Reynoso, just call me Beto. I'm going to be showcasing just one robot, and then I'm going to go ahead and do a screen share and show you some other robots and a laser machine I built recently that's doing gears, plastic gears, and just cutting stuff up out of wood, and it could also do engraving like this stuff here. I'm sure you can see that.
Hold that one real steady for everybody. And so that's a laser engraving.
Exactly.
And is that on plywood?
Yes, it's on 3/4-inch plywood, or rocker pine wood, and actually here's a little test runs I did so I can check out the gradients, and this is kind of like the final result. So this is a summer robotics camp students, and
great, yeah. So it looks like they're sitting in the middle of the soccer field that the mini Darwins have been playing soccer at.
Precisely. So, well, here though we get to play with the Vex Robotics platform. So we bought a lot of these robotics kits, and so we teach theory as well as application. And I want to show you a robot that's actually running right now. And so this robot here, you all are showing your robots, so I want to show one of my robots here. So this is a self-balancing robot. It's it uses a propeller processor. It's got a A123 batteries. It's a custom battery pack. I went ahead and bought back in the day, the DeWalt battery packs off eBay, and I just did that and made the battery pack from scratch. It's about 12 volts. I got a regulator up here that drops it down to and sends it out to the other regulator, which is 5 volts, and then, of course, another regulator for 3.3 down to the propeller processor. So it's running 8 cores. So instead of the Arduino typical of it using timers and interrupts, here I'm using cores. And so I dedicate a core for serial communication, a core for filtering the sensors, another core for doing the common, another core for fusing sensor data, and then, of course, another core for the PID algorithm. And so it balances entirely on its own. Right now it's a little low battery, but the PID algorithm is quite robust. I can definitely give it a little tweak, and the derivative kicks in, and I could also do gradual, and then it comes to a steady stop. The wheels are, you know, typical RC truck wheels that you can buy online. The motors are 12 volt. They have encoders, of which I'm not using. I'm also using the Sabertooth, the X25, the 25 amp motor controller, which is talking through serial to the propeller processor. And that's just about it for this this little robot. I built this about 5 years ago when I was doing a little internship at the University of Southern California's Robotics Embedded Systems Laboratory. This is a sensor here, so I'm just using two accelerometers and one gyro for this application. But it has 5 degrees of freedom.
Great.
So I'm going to go ahead and switch gears here and begin the screen share.
As you set that up, I just want to say that's a really cool that's a really cool setup. I'm impressed. It's nice to I'm always impressed by the self-balancing applications.
It's why I took that beast, because I was just as fascinated by the Segways and the quadcopters of the time, and I went ahead and I had no idea how to begin, and I just began learning how to program at the time, and this came out.
That's great. That's an encouraging story as well.
Yeah, he's being kind of modest too with his capabilities. If you look at his resume and his bio, he's being a little modest about his programming and robotic skills.
Can you guys see that?
We can. Yep, that looks great.
Perfect. So I can't really show you all the robots, but I'll show you pictures. So these are some of the robots. I began building robots at the age of 14, and very quickly took this on. It went from hobby to a passion, and just as you all. And I of course started with Legos, as many of you all may have, and moved my way on up there. And I'm going to show you, move on, switch gears now, and I'm going to start talking about a machine I recently built this summer to do exactly what I just showed you before, which is laser engraving and cutting out gears that are 1-inch thick. So I built the platform, of course. This is totally low budget. I went to Home Depot and I bought all the wood and made it happen. This is the ghetto route. I went ahead and bought a $3 laser pointer, mounted this Lexan sheet right in front of it with a 1/8 inch hole. I shot that laser from one end of the gantry to the other side. And so here's it shooting off that little hole. It lands on the other end, of course, and it shoots. It's supposed to be dead center. And of course, the reflectors, I go from reflector to reflector. These are silicon reflectors. And so here you have the laser tube. This is a 150 watt laser power tube at 22,000 volts at about 28 milliamps. So this can cut about 1-inch thick non-ferrous plastic materials such as plastics, leather, wood, and so this is kind of what I use to build robots now.
Super cool.
Yeah, classy. That's so. Will it do aluminum?
So it could only do very thin aluminum, about less than 1/16 inch thick. As well as it could also do the fancy behind the, you know, on the back of the iPhone, the anodized aluminum look. It does that quite well, as well as on stainless steel. So this is capped on tape. I used just to center the laser on each reflector. And this is what I just showed you, and this is it in action. So it pulses at about 350 millimeters a second, shooting and of course gradually controlling the laser intensity to give that 3D look.
Yes, absolutely. So how long did that image itself take with this setup?
About an hour.
That's about an hour?
Right, because this is high res. I went ahead. Usually what you can do is you can reduce the number of lines for resolution, but I went ahead and I think I went like 0.001 millimeters. So it just actually went too high, more than it should actually. So it took too long. This is of course the final picture.
That's the original right there.
Precisely. So these are the summer robotics camp students, and this kind of is a perfect segue, pun intended, to the summer robotics camp, which I was mentioned to speak on. And so these are 24 of our summer camp students this past summer. And so this is the laser, and I mixed up the images here. On the bottom, you see the 1500 watt cooler. It runs water through the laser tube and just to cool it down. Otherwise, there's a little meltdown. I want to go ahead and add a third axis so I can do 3D laser sintering. So imagine being able to do titanium, steel, plastic, and I currently have nano glass particles. I'm going to see if I can actually. Okay, perfect.
You kind of made it like into like 3D printer in a sense, didn't you, with the glass?
Well, this is the glass. So I got this. Yeah. I met a professor about an hour away from here in UTPA, and he said, I'm actually creating these nanoparticles in my lab, and I'd like for you to have a pound of it. And he said, it's pretty expensive, but you can have it for free. And I just began experimenting, and what my goal is to create 3D nanoglass particle structure structures, and so using this stuff. And I don't intend to open it up because it's quite fine. It's about 300 nanometers each particle. God knows what it can do, but if it coats your lungs, you definitely die. That's not good.
Not good at all.
At all.
But
go ahead.
That it sounds like you would start. You're looking at the laser sintering, 3D laser sintering with glass, then.
Precisely. Yes. So initially, that's just to start off with. And my issue right now is that the laser beam, is 1,064 nanometers. So it's about 1 micron. The particles though are 300 to 400 nanometers. So my job now is to buy another laser that's at 300 nanometer wavelength, so I could play at that range. And so my goal later down the road is to start selling these kind of robots. I built this robot when I was in college, and I want to start mass producing these and start selling them to schools. Of course, using Arduino Nanos and typical hobby servos and Bluetooth modules that can talk over Android phones and as well as PCs, so students can begin programming in Arduino locally, and that's unheard of. In South Texas.
Yeah. And so for everyone that's watching, that's where you're located. You said you're in Brownsville, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes, Brownsville, Texas, on the border by the sea. It's a low socioeconomic area, and there's quite some poverty down here, and this is just a way for me to infiltrate the school districts and begin with a show of force through robotics and to kind of merge exactly what we're doing with the summer robotics camps. We get funded by the Texas Workforce Commission every summer to fund these camps, but my goal is for these students to start playing with Arduinos and start creating their own applications and hopefully maybe even their own businesses.
That's great. It's really great.
I'm going to go back to the laser very quickly, and this is just the design of the third axis, which I'm going to begin building in about 2 weeks. And of course, these are the nanoglass particles being burnt by. My goal was to first melt the glass, and once I got that done, now my goal is to go three dimensions. And of course, this is real horrible quality. I wasn't heating the bed as you normally would with 3D plastic printers. In this case, I was just using ceramic as the base, but my next substrate will be tungsten. And of course, that's the laser doing its thing.
Looks great.
And so these are the summer students. We went ahead and bought in very heavily into the VEX robotics platform. We're going to go ahead and do and start creating the robots entirely from scratch on the laser and using Arduinos. So the first day, of course, for any summer robotics camp is very quiet. Everybody's just looking at each other, and this is exactly how they look.
Yeah.
Towards the end of the week, they're bouncing off the walls, and they start building these robots. And what we do is we teach every morning about 1 hour of theory. We teach them pulse modulation, compound gears, you know, typical data acquisition, analog inputs. We teach them Ohm's law. We have industry speakers from NASA, SpaceX, General Electric, over teleconference. We just cover the whole spectrum, essentially. Here we cover the trigonometry and how that applies to GPS and sonar and radar and real world applications. And of course, every once in a while we go home, we're like, okay, so now we need to build them a new field. And so we go to Home Depot, we buy the rug, and we spray paint the white on it, and we host competitions for these kids to let their creations run wild. And of course, apply the theory that we've taught them all week. So here's some other stuff we built at home and for them to compete in. We also have underwater robotics. And so this is buoyancy, center of mass, and torque. And of course, every day they go ahead and do a log and talk about their robots and as well as some designs. So
yeah. Are those notes from one of the students?
Yes, yeah. It's one of the better note takers.
Yeah, those look really great illustrations. Yeah, absolutely.
So we have this idea for this competition. Okay, just grab the ball and place it on top of the half-inch PVC hole, and we're like, they're not gonna make it. They won't make it. And so, you know, they realize that, you know, we increase the increase the ratio on the gearing, and we're going to get slower speed, but we're going to get higher accuracy, resolution, and that's exactly what they did, and they were able to conquer that, to our amazement, after the first week and a half.
Wow.
Cool. So that pretty much ends it.
How long does the program run for?
It's an entire month. We have 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. sessions from Monday to Friday. So okay. We pretty much just ask the parents, drop them off at 9 a.m. and pick them up at 4 p.m. We take care of lunch. We take care of buying the robots. We already have about $30,000 in robots and hardware and all kinds of stuff. It's pretty much an environment. We build an environment for them to get creative, play with Arduinos, program in C. For the VEX platform, they programmed in Robot C, and then for the Arduinos, it's in C. And it's kind of just get their feet wet and for them to understand STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, at a deeper level, and of course, merge it with application. Generally, it's always theory, but our goal was to merge it with application in a beautiful way, and they've fallen in love with robotics, and most of them want to go on and work for NASA and SpaceX and God knows what other companies. So it's quite humbling experience, at least for me, since I began building robots with just a soldering iron and a drill I borrowed. And I would use quarter-inch Lexan and plexiglass, and that's how I would create my 90-degree angles. And I got a robot here, which I'll show you. This robot I built when I was 14 years old, and this is how I began building robots for competitions. And I didn't have any mentors. I didn't have anybody help me out. And here we're having these fancy robotics camps. These robotics camps for these kids, and I show these robots to these kids so that they understand that they have it good. But that kind of ends my little session. Yeah. But if you have any questions, shoot.
There's a bunch of questions popping up. One of the first ones I have, the program that you're working with, is that something that's just local to Brownsville, or is this something that's part of a national program that people in other communities can get involved with?
Right, so we get funded by the Texas Workforce Commission, and every year, we were the first summer we got funded for $75,000. The second summer this past summer we got funded for about $140,000. And so it's funded by the Texas Workforce Commission. So if you have a student that's in a Texas school that is 14 to 17 years old, you can definitely apply to our camp. All we ask for is that you arrive at 9 a.m. and you leave at 4 p.m. And that's essentially. There's other grants available nationwide that I've been hearing on, and I can definitely post that on the Robot Hacks community on Google Plus and. So that others whom are interested can send in a proposal and perhaps even have their own summer robotics camp. So I got a friend in Alaska, though, that wants for me to go and do a summer robotics camp over there with $1 million. I don't know how that's going to work out. I was like, that's more than enough money, but it's too cold for me. I'm from South Texas.
Well, I would love to see this happen from coast to coast.
Yes.
This is great stuff. And I know that there are programs out there, like FIRST Robotics does a lot of great things, but the real classroom element that, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, immersive aspect of it, I think is really where that learning just explodes.
Exactly.
So one of the questions that's popping up here from the viewers was Rick Hill's wondering, what's the payload capacity? And I'm not sure which one he's referring to, but I'm assuming it might be that last one that you just showed, one of the first robots you built.
Okay, so these are using the Servo City, the robot sewing gearboxes, so it's a 5-to-1 gear ratio. So each servo puts out, it's about 2,000 ounces an inch. That's about... On a 4-inch arm, that's about 30 pounds of force, although these are on like 12 inches. I would say, let's just say I put my finger on that and it hurt a lot on the gripper, of course.
To break it down into pure scientific measurement, it hurts.
It hurts a lot, definitely. And it's so powerful, though, that the plastic D-ring gears broke. So I went ahead and upgraded to metal gears soon after that. It's a work in progress, and I'm going to upgrade it to the propeller processor, and I've already spent a lot of money just up trying to fix it. But it's my favorite robot because
everybody
it's one
does,
of the first
yeah.
ones.
Yeah,
one of the first ones I built. So.
And then another question. Ricardo Hall's asking, what do I need to do this in college? And this is a question really just for everybody.
Oh wow.
What's your feelings about this?
Well, my story in college was I was building robots in high school. I loved it. I wanted to do it as a career, a lifetime, and I chose mechanical engineering because I didn't know better. And I quickly realized that I wasn't going to reinvent the wheel. And I knew I wasn't going to create a fancy circuit board and have someone in China create it for 1/10 the price. So I went ahead and chose computer science because I chose the future robotics was through artificial intelligence. And it sure is. We have, at best, our robots are as smart as cockroaches. And we need to create that quantum computer. We need to create that next level of technology, nanotech materials like carbon nanotubes, and create materials that are strong. Create the carbon nanotubes essentially will get us a battery that's about this size and have mobile robots that with enough juice to kind of like an Iron Man suit. So I chose artificial intelligence because we still don't have the depth perception, the computer vision, the machine learning algorithms to get us there.
Great. That's yeah, and that's what I would encourage all of these viewers that are interested in this to really look at the engineering programs. I think mechanical is great, but there's a lot of exciting stuff happening in computer science, electrical engineering, mechatronics.
Yes.
Lots of great places.
Go
ahead.
Oh, I just wanted to mention that right now there's a lot of universities merging their computer science and electrical engineering departments, and I know Berkeley has had that for a while, MIT, and my local university had just did that. There's a lot of universities around the nation that are doing that, and that's, I think, the best program out there if you want to learn DSP and high-level computer science.
Great. Well, thanks, Berto. This is, along with everybody, this stuff's fantastic. And please post the links to the program.
Yes.
And to any of the project stuff that you're working on. I want to continue to follow up with you because there's a lot of cool stories with this. Michael, I think we've got one more person. We've got Lem, who's our one participant who is coming from the furthest distance from where we are. He's out in Japan right now, and so he's been patient. Told us he just finished eating his breakfast. So, Michael, why don't you go ahead and introduce him?
Okay, yeah, you probably know him from his website, Robot Dreams. But I think you've been in Japan for over 20 years now. Is that correct?
Well, I first came to Japan in 1982. And I've lived here for about 25 years in total, I think.
Great. So, Lem, it looks like we've got a little bit of a delay from the video and audio. Real quick, before we jump into the meat and potatoes of your presentation, can you do just a quick screen refresh with a Command-R-Control-R? That should kick you back in, and we'll wait patiently. 20 years in Japan, that's an impressive amount of time, and there's lots of cool things happening, obviously, all over the globe. And this fun thing about this... This group of participants that you've brought us, Michael, is that it really is a multinational group.
Yes. Try that again, Lim.
Oh, and don't forget to unmute yourself up there in the top corner.
Yeah, I did. I just did.
Super. Okay. Better? It sounds good. Yeah, that's great. Much, much cleaner.
Yeah, one of the things that really attracted me to robotics was the fact that it is multinational. Mike and I met at RoboGames quite a few years ago, probably 5 years ago, something like that. And the community was fantastic. It's people from all over the world and lots of interaction and lots of openness and sharing. So yeah, that was a big, very big turn on.
That's great. So... tell us, how did you end up in Japan again?
Well, originally I came over in 1982. I was providing technical support for the McDonnell Douglas Unigraphics software, and they signed up a distributor in Japan and needed somebody to come over and support all the systems here. So I came over. It was supposed to be a year assignment, and I ended up staying for 6 years that time. Went back to the States, came back over with Sun Microsystems, went back and then started working for a Japanese company and then came back over again. And I've got the Japanese equivalent of a green card. I can do everything except vote.
And tell us again, what part of Japan are you in?
I'm just east of Tokyo, about 35 minutes outside of Tokyo by express train.
Great. Mm-hmm. So tell us about your robotics projects.
Well, I first got involved with humanoid robotics around 2003, 2004, when Kondo came out with the KHR-1, which was the first humanoid robotics kit. And I put one of those together, was publishing the Robot Streams blog, actually an early version of that, and started getting engaged with the Robo-1 community here, the humanoid robots. And, you know, that was fascinating, but one of the restrictions or frustrations that I had was that you could go and buy a kit, but it was a condo robot, or it was a another high-tech Robonova or something like that. It was the manufacturer's robot. It wasn't my robot. Okay, right. And so I was always trying to modify and change the robots to add some of my own personality, my own thoughts, and my own ideas. And then when 3D printing came out and became available, I got a 3D printer. I actually have a Tantalus, which was developed in Vancouver, Canada. And like everybody else, I started making, you know, these, you know, printing lots of Yoda heads and other things from Thingiverse. And then started focusing on, well, what can you do to create something that you need? You know, what's a pragmatic or practical application? I'm heavily involved in aquaponics as well, so I started designing and printing out special fixtures. Most of the stuff is PVC pipe, and you go to a hardware store and you put it together, but you can't really find what you need. And so I developed a lot of these. And with the website and all the videos that I do, I wanted to improve my equipment, you know, get more equipment. So I designed a tracking dolly. Okay, so this is completely 3D printed. It has a couple of metal bearings and a camera mount. And then I put together, had some bars from an old, actually metal storage rack, and printed fixtures for those. And then I can mount the camera and just roll it across there, and I've got a tracking dolly that would cost you probably $300 if you bought it, or more if you bought it in the store. And my total investment besides the time was probably about $25 or something, because I had to print it several times before I got it right. I had to buy bearings and a little fixture on the top to mount the camera. One of my inspirations was an incident that happened at RoboGames with Michael and Shibata, the developer of a lot of the humanoid robots here. He was coming over for RoboGames, and he was going to compete in the hardcore mech war. But he didn't have time to actually design some parts that he needed. And so he designed a shield, which Michael can show you there, on the plane, and sent it to Michael as soon as he got off the plane. And Michael found somebody in the Bay Area that had a 3D printer, and they printed it out and brought it over to the game venue and mounted it on the robot, and then he could compete. So it was that international community plus the ability to modify things in real time that was, wow, man, we can really do this. We can really make robots our own.
Awesome.
I recently got a DJI Phantom quadcopter, and I wanted to fly it and take a lot of video. But one of the challenges with the mounting a camera on the quadcopter is you get coupling between the rotors, the motors, and the camera. So you get what they call a jello vibration in there. And I was about to take off on a trip to the States and didn't have time to order a vibration mount online. So I went to the local hardware store, and I found some foam, and I found some O-rings. So I designed a camera mount for the bottom of the quadcopter and incorporated the GoPro mount on the other side and used the O-rings for the mechanical isolation. So there's no... It's totally flexible, right? And this took me about one day. You know, I got the idea, I printed it out once, modified it, printed it out again, and then test flew it, and then I was ready to get on my plane, and I ended up flying this in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and it totally eliminates the vibration problem. I'm really interested in now is the application of this type of technology, like 3D printing, to robotics, okay? And I'm really interested in and pursuing this in two ways. One is taking kits or taking other existing devices, you know, like Michael's done, both Michaels have done, and changing them to suit your own needs. You know, you want to first print out the brackets for Darwin and create that robot, and then change it and modify it. You can put a different head on it. You can put a different body on it. That's one of the reasons I'm so excited about the new Darwin Mini coming out from Robotist, is not because of the robot itself, but the fact that you can actually modify it. If I want to put a Yoda head on there, or I want to put my friend's head, or I want to add different sensors, people asked about gyros and accelerometers. Yes, you can do that because everything is open source. If you want to put proximity sensors, if you want to put other grippers, you know, design you know, special grippers, you can do that because it's open source and you've got affordable 3D printing. So that's tremendously exciting for me.
Yeah. And that's one of the things that, that's interesting, the 3D printing aspect. You know, we've touched on that throughout this discussion today, but it really has helped launch the ability for people at home to do at-home robotics projects in a way that there you just couldn't have done before. You know, the ability to iterate through numerous types of frames and components, it's really so crucial to this.
It's an enabler. It gives you the ability to do that, and it also changes the way that you think about things. You know, for example, when I started off with the KHR1, the body is folded sheet metal. Okay, so when you design a humanoid robot and your fabrication technology is bending sheet metal, then you tend to look at everything in Cartesian coordinates. Everything is right angles. You're going to bend it because you know you can't make complex angles or complex surfaces with that. But with 3D printing, suddenly you don't need to follow that. So what I'm seeing here in Japan, and I saw at Robot World in Korea when I was over there, is robot builders starting to look at things in a more organic sense. You know, right. Things don't have to be right angles. You don't have to be stiff. Human bodies aren't that way. Animals aren't that way. So your creations, like Michael has done with his basketball-shaped robot, you can explore very cheaply and easily things that you would never consider doing before. And then the advent of relatively low-cost servos and controllers like the CM9 and the new servos is really going to make this take off, because people are going to be able to develop robust, relatively high-performance robots at an affordable cost.
Definitely, yeah, and it goes beyond just the framework stuff. You know, the electronics are a big part of that, and you know, suddenly we've got ourselves a robot factory in the consumer and amateur world. It's really great.
Yeah,
already has our robot factory. Yeah,
yeah. Even beyond that, the work that you guys are doing with Make and putting together Hangouts like this is fantastic, because in order to try anything, people need to be able to believe that they can do it, right?
Right.
And so giving people examples like we've seen today and the other Hangouts that Make provides online and the publications, that is fantastic, because people can say, oh, Michael did this or Aaron did this, and they're just like me, and I can do it too.
Yeah, definitely. Well, Lem, I think, you know, this is a great perspective on a lot of this. Some cool applications. I like hearing about the camera dolly project that helped launch you into some of the first parts of getting involved in these things. You know, it's something that I spend a lot of time thinking about, just out of personal interest. And you're right; those things are very expensive to buy commercially. And then growing from there into, you know, this thinking in 3D and the way that it really is helping things evolve. Mm-hmm. And that's the future. It really is. It's something we spend a lot of time talking about in the office here. Mm-hmm. So one question that that's popping up here is specifically about 3D printers. Thomas Shepard's asking about which printers does everyone use, and curious about which is best for a novice. But Lem, you had mentioned a Canadian 3D printer, and I forget which one you said it was. And it looks like I'm trying to see if I've got audio for you. If it, I see movement,
yeah.
But I'm not hearing audio at the moment.
I'm still on.
Okay, good. So I think the video may be have unsynced itself again. So you may be a little bit a little bit back. But which was? Let's run through everyone real quick and hear which printers is everyone using. Go ahead, Lem. We'll start with you.
I'm using Tantalus. It's tantalus.org. It's a RepRap derivative, and I like it a lot. But it's not commercially available. You have to go to the website and then download everything and build it yourself.
Okay. Not surprised that you've built your own. Michael Curry, I've got a pretty good assumption of which one you might be using, but why don't you go ahead and tell us?
Yeah, no, I'm actually an employee of MakerBot Industries, so they pay for the bills and the plastic cost here, so I'm a huge fan of the MakerBot Replicator 2. It is a little pricier than the other options out there, but will get you printing reliably out of the box right away.
Super. And then and Michael Overstreet, you said you've been using Affinia and Up?
Yeah, my printer is the Up 1.2 version. It's the same as the Affinia printer. I find it is super sweet. The software is so easy to use. That's what I think is the big benefit of the printer.
Yeah, always a helpful part. And the Affinia did it. It did really well in our 3D printer roundup last year. We've got the Make 3D Printer roundup for this year. We'll be announcing the results in a couple days on Friday. So for those of you guys who are watching who are curious about that, we'll be revealing the latest selections. Berto, are you doing much 3D printing, or are you primarily working in the laser cutting realm?
That's actually the school I'm helping out and mentoring for the first robotics competition. They just got their 3D printer like 2 days ago, so I'll be helping them out this Saturday. So I haven't been playing with 3D printers. I just now have a laser, and I'm modifying to do 3D printing, either via steel, titanium, plastic, with either ABS or PLA. But I'm entirely new to that realm.
Yeah, it's... there's lots of exciting stuff happening in it. Chi and Matthew, Chi, do you have 3D printers you guys are using at University of Georgia?
Yeah, some myself, I don't use them yet, but the other people have used MakerBot, and I've seen some Delphinia too. So
okay,
we use a lot in for student in freshman introduction to engineering, so they have something quick prototyping. So immediately they can see that product, so we do that.
Yeah, super. And then Aaron at Robotist, are you guys doing much with as you prototype any of these, like the Darwin Mini?
I believe so, but here in U.S. office we don't have anything here yet.
I might be able to help on this. They're one of the lead designers, J.K. He has a Replicator 2, and he showed me some parts he's printed on it. They also have like a high-end dimension printer too, but yes, the Darwin Mini, it was all prototyped on 3D printing at the Robotist office in Korea.
Great, super. So we still have a bunch of questions here, but I think that it might be best that these ones are all going to be part of the Robot Hacks community page So maybe what we'll do is jump into the ones that we haven't answered yet online after the event's over, and we can type in some of the responses here for those of you guys who haven't had your questions answered. So we can let everybody get moving and get their evenings and in some of your cases your mornings moving along. This has been a fantastic roundup of robotics experts.
Yeah, I want to thank everybody for spending the time and getting into this hangout, because I've enjoyed it myself. Just listening to everybody talk, and this has been very cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks, Michael, for inviting us.
Oh, no problem.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody, for
organizing all this.
Thank you.
Yeah, and thanks, Michael, for pulling everyone in. This is really great. So for once again, for those of you guys who are watching, make sure to stay active with the Robot Hacks community. You can get to the main content by going to makezine.com/robot-hacks, and from there you can learn about all of the different pieces that are in place for this program. There's the community where we're seeing the different projects that our participating teams have been working on, and hear about the expert makers that we've been chatting with today and with our last session. And our next one, which is November 13th, that's a week from now, where we have it's a real great program. We've got Gail Langvin and Chuck Fletcher, who are working on the InMove 3D printable humanoid robot. This is a large scale, almost life size 3D printable open source robot project, and it's beautiful and it's very exciting, and it's going to be another fantastic program where we get to hear about the inception of this, where it's at right now and where it's going in the future. So tune in on the 13th and then on the 20th when we do our wrap-up show and tell with all of the participating teams. Until then, keep commenting, and we'll be answering questions, and we look forward to seeing you guys soon. So thanks, everyone, and have a good one.
Well, have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.